Hey guys, what's going on? I'm trying to get through this like just for your final exam for, a study guide for you guys. I had the exam right here, so I want to go through this and trying to help you narrow down what's going to be on study. Might take a couple of videos here, and plus this is good review anyway, just for even at the end of the year, just what we do. So I know what people are going to think. They're going to think like I'm going to go through like, oh, number one, you should choose C or D. No, that's not going to happen. Okay. But for those people who, kind of already had their study guide, which you must turn in by tomorrow, before class time. I understand we didn't have any school today. So maybe some people need to get in here who see me second period. Somebody get in the morning, print out a copy of your study guide with your names on top. You have to get that into me, okay? You have to, all right? So, and before we get like, on the exam, all right? So, if you follow along with me though, it will narrow some of your scope. You shouldn't have to be here all day on a Monday studying and putting things in the study guide. You got to know about, maybe. Thinking like, well, wait a minute now. What again is, the head right system? What is primary geometry laws? Maybe so just to kind of narrow your scope for those people studying. For those others who are just like, hey, I'm cool with an 81, I'm cool with a 78, I'm cool with whatever I get and everything like that because, my math grade is A++, my biology is A++, English 3 is A++. Then hey, you know what? Good enough for you. I'm definitely not, like I say, here to judge you. So, and I was just looking through my old papers and looking at just about success. And it really is something that I wish people that I always admire students who work so hard. I admire that, like, our athletes who work so hard and they're able to, like, always see it as a success. But it really is a lot of hard work, dedication, and things that they want to do. And they're looking for excellence, they're not looking for mediocrity. I'm not saying that every student's going to be able to do that and everything, but you just admire some of your fellow classmates who, try to put their all into their academic work like that, and try to see success. Other people try to do it in other areas to try to achieve success. But you have a lot of your classmates here right now really trying to put in the work to do this. And I really want, really, it's kind of more directed in a way to them because they'll be able to catch on a little bit better. Instead of trying to do things like last minute, or try to say, oh, I'm going to get serious for this week or something like that, And again, I'm not trying to put kids down or not like, really motivated. It's who you are. It's what you are. All right. I'm going to go through this. I'm actually going to look there and try to, again, just so you can narrow your scope. I see I'm looking here, going through the numbers and stuff. All right. So, in addition, because I just got started on this, I'm already 3 minutes in. I'm probably gonna have two of these on the top of the Moodle, not yet, because I want to go ahead and get started on this, get this out to you. I'm gonna have some supplemental like resources, like four or five resources for you on top of the Moodle. So that will be on top of the Moodle, like comparing first and second grade awakening, some of the things I'm going over here. In addition, I'll try to like write some stuff down here, so like some of the words that may be hard to pronounce. First two or three questions just take out of it. A lot of you guys don't understand here that like before European contact, you had a lot of civilizations and just not once by Aztecs, Incas, and Mayas down here in Latin America. You might know, like the mound builders, Cahokia. Like what made them kind of like superior and so like what was their characteristics? I love the Iroquois too as well in the Northeast in New York. There's some other stuff too. So you think about what were the three sisters? Corn, beans, and squash. When did they start cultivating those crops and everything? Maybe what location? Thinking about how they migrated over here. And then that's always big importance. Next, we come into the timeline is European contact. Not really stuff about Columbus, but you get the Spanish, the English, all right, and the French. I'll have a supplemental form on there about comparing and contrasting. Think about the Spanish. You already think about like the Encomienda system, the Black Legend, maybe, kind of overhyped how like they treated the Native Americans compared to the English and French, kind of use that propaganda that the Spanish were like, bad, creating this kind of like social stratification, peninsulares on top, like, the Native Americans and the black slaves are going to import is going to be like, really set up these kind of like, social class. But what about the English though? English are, thinking about coming over here. Open immigration, all right? Corporations, really not country directed. You have a lot more English sponsored people over here for economic, religious reasons, other reasons. The Spanish and French don't really do this. And that's really why they don't tend to kind of like, as flourish as much as probably like our, ancestors from like, the colonial times here from the English. I mean, you're gonna see that people are going to, they're gonna be like, hey, if you want to migrate here, you want to be involved in this corporate like sponsorship, you want to be involved in this kind of like, religious aspect and get out of England anyway. We don't want you here. Good enough. You find a place. We don't have to pay any money. Go ahead. All right. So, and you're gonna see the different relationships kind of in a way that Native American. So you should hand that down because I'm always comparing and contrasting that data fact here. Motivations for age of exploration. Some of my choices, I mean, guys, is just you have about four or five choices. You have to know motivation for age of exploration for the Protestant Reformation, to, all the interests and spices, the overland routes. That stuff I think you should have down, but make sure that you know about like, so many, like saying spread Christianity, God, gold, and glory, all those things on here. If I'm looking at looking on here, like on the sheet, so make sure you kind of like, keep that tab in mind. So make just you don't have to look at this video. You can listen to it, and you know, like I said, and just make little tabulations as you're going around here. So once you get the colonies, I love too about comparing and contrasting is the English colonization of Massachusetts, like say New England, compared to like, Jamestown. And really, I think it really comes down to Massachusetts Bay. We're going to say a lot about that families instead of like, single men, just a geographical location, less disease. But, really think about Massachusetts Bay, just like you say, well, how did the Mormons like, are able to like, settle on this barren, like, Salt Lake City area? It's organization. They came over here with already said about house building. Who's going to be responsible for like, the food preparation? Who are going to like, work the farms? What skilled people do we need? That's how the Mormons, when they're moving from Nauvoo, to moving from Ohio, being expelled, it's like, okay, they're not going to make it or whatever like that. How do people are able to like, settle down? Well, see, the Puritans, as you know, along with the Pilgrims being out, out in Holland too, they're already kind of like these ostracized settled communities, entrepreneurs in a way, like again, selling stuff and everything. So it was more of a fit for them to come over here. And as we know, unfortunately, the Native Americans have already been decimated on the East Coast with contact with the Europeans for disease. So it's a little bit more open than you think. I'm not trying to say it's vacant and everything or unoccupied land by no means. But so you say that. New England colonists, a little bit more organized, a little bit more able to fit this in here, will be able to have more success than the Jamestown colony. Very good. And think about this for sure. Know some different colonies. I'm going to put something down on like on the folder there. It's always good to know about what you named the two New England colonies from a Connecticut to a Massachusetts to even New Hampshire to New York and Delaware, the middle to the Chesapeake and Southern colony, and what made some of those different. I always say the God and Cod in New England, the lumber, the diversity in the middle colonies. They're kind of like, in between the Southern colonies. You need to kind of, know that and everything like that. Pennsylvania, William Penn, 1681. Yeah, I'll throw out some dates, but you don't have to remember the dates. But we know right now the first like set of questions is going to be like in the 17th and like 16th centuries here and everything going on there. It's going to be in a mostly chronological order here, so that you'll be settled with. All right, cool. So I'm just looking on here, trying to give the best hints as you can here. On here for those people who listen up and everything, so you won't have to be on tonight. You know, I love that, you know, right now you're getting into the culture aspect, you're getting into the, you know, 18th century, first great awakening. And if I talk about the first great awakening, I talk about the second great awakening. Mostly they have more things in common. You can become religious, you can convert, you don't need a high church, you don't need a bishop. First and second great awakening. It's about the individual, it's your relationship with God. But you know what we're both worried about in the first and second great awakening? All these, you know, similarities. I'm gonna put something in the folder about this too. That they both was trying to say, like, look, we're losing people. We're losing, like, first great awakening, these congregationalists are killing us. Like, say, that's the Puritans. They're kind of killing us with this kind of like the way they, like, you know, preach the Bible and like that, you know, and the way they're just, they don't seem to be motivated in, like, you know, in teaching anybody. How do we attract people? How do we do this? So you really see the beginning, the growing denominations of, like, you know, Methodists and Presbyterians in the first great awakening, the growing of colleges, Brown University, because they want people to be educated to know about, like, again, religion and think for the betterment of society too, as well, to be trained, to be useful, that you can do something. You cannot just be predestined and, you know, and just be one of the elect or the, you know, that's going to, like, you know, go to heaven and everything. You know, there are some things that you can do. Jonathan Edwards into the hands of angry God. And it's also, as you know, going to pull the colonists together and say, hey, you know, we're creating our own kind of, like, you know, unique religion that's different from the Anglicanism in your in England. And plus, this is really going to really th think about relationship to democracy, individualism as well. So again, first great awakening. Second great awakening, you always think about reform, utopian movements, kind of like, you know, helping out other people, slavery, women, what can be exposed to society that you can do even greater things than just, like, you know, again, being, you know, saved and everything. Like, you can almost, like, you can not only save yourself, but you can save others too. And that's what you should do. All right. That's second great awakening. Moving on here about, you know, think about democracy. You think about, you know, the influences here. Don't forget about Mayflower Compact, which you probably learned since first grade about 1620. Fundamentals of Order of Connecticut, the town hall meetings, and there, you know, that goes in there. You even had the Glorious Revolution that happened in 1688 over there in England. But they, after that year, 1689, they passed an English Bill of Rights. So you see this kind of, like, influence of growing democracy, the Enlightenment. Again, one of the causes of the American Revolution that, you know, people don't really think about, like, again, everything, you know, about cause of American Revolution that's down the road. You know, it's coming up in 1676, Bacon's Rebellion, and Bacon's Rebellion is what that does is just going to, like, you know, start saying that, hey, these indentured servants are getting out of control. Is there another labor force that you know, which is much needed in the southern colonies that we turn to? It start turning more towards African slaves. But Bacon's Rebellion is more about that. It reminds you of the Regulator Movement. It reminds you of the Pacts and Boers in Pennsylvania. The Indians are, like, you know, attacking the settlers, and, you know, who's going to control the peace? People being overtaxed, and they don't feel like they're being represented in these general colonial assemblies. So what is going on here? So always comparing and contrasting, you know, to the other rebellions at the time. Remember, rebellions are usually not as successful, like, again, you know, or uprisings as revolutions are, like that. So, but come always, like, where is Bacon's Rebellion compared to? And think about that, you know. Colonies, like, again, you know, think about, like, you know, what made the Carolinas, like, some of their crops and everything. Please, you know, if you're in the early 18th century, late 17th century, you know, I'm not talking about cotton. You know, you're talking about, again, or the rice, the indigo, the tree, the lumber, North Carolina, the tar, the pitch, things of that nature here. That's, like, you know, really making the Carolinas and the South rich. Yes, tobacco is going to be cultivated, and it's going to be the first, like, you know, major cash crop at the time and everything until the market is flooded, because, you know, the West Indies are growing as much as it is competing as well with this and everything to the market. All right. You know, now you need my favorite word, of course, is I'm always saying this, what is the, you know, economic relationship, you know? And you got to think about these two words in a way, salutary neglect and mercantilism. What is the timeline of those? Well, you know, when the colonies were first coming over and being settled, really, it was kind of a benign neglect instead of some kind of official economic policy. Like, I don't know what they're doing over there. You know, you're James versus James II. Plus, you know, they're having an English Civil War. Puritans are leaving because, you know, you have Charles I, who's like, you know, kind of like, you know, kicking a lot of them out or persecuting them as well and everything. So, really, 17th century, early 17th century, it's kind of like, leave them alone because I don't even know what's going on over there for the most part, you know. But around the 1650s, you get these navigation acts, and then you get these specific acts in the 1690s. You can say now, you can say from kind of benign neglect, you get a little bit more of this mercantilist relationship. Enumerated goods, things that have to be listed, things that have to be going to the, like, you know, the British ports first, whether that be in the West Indies or whether that be England, or whether and also be on the English ships. Around with Queen Anne, you get, like, you know, the unification of England. You don't have to know that. It's just like it becomes like Great Britain, you know, like, you know, Scotland and Wales. And they're always, as you know, this time of early, you know, 18th century, before the French and Indian War, they're fighting, you know, France, they're fighting Spain, they're fighting Austria, the Habsburgs, it's all going on here. You know, like again, Queen Anne's War, War of Algiers. So at this time, you know, what they're saying at this time, Robert Walpole saying, look, you know, it's just kind of a salutary neglect. The English colonies are doing good over there. There's no use of, like, you know, crunching down on enforcing them. And by the way, we're just too busy with so much other stuff anyway. I don't know what they're doing. I don't even know if we can enforce some of these laws here, you know. Yeah, they begin to change about 1750s, but you know when it really, you know, drops down the colonies is the end of the French and Indian War. And hopefully, I think you should be around that date, 1763. That's when they begin to think, like, you know, so, and start, you know, revamping some of these acts and everything, you know. So, with the Sugar Act, the Currency Act, and the one you guys love, you know, the Stamp Act. But it begins there where you get that salutary kind of rigor comes back or kind of mercantilism returns. So you see that kind of like a neglect here, kind of like the bottom out here, and then you get that tightening of grip of the mercantilism, then again, the loosening up. Again, salutary neglect, and then coming back with by salutary rigor and mercantilism. They kind of, again, know those kind of like spaces of those years of what was happening at the time. All right. Well, I know I'm going fast, but don't worry. I mean, I just, you know, just listen up to what I'm saying because I'm following along here about some of the things that, you know, that you should know. All right. And again, some. I don't know why people always look for a magic bullet. They're like, well, you know, I listen to Mr. Price and, you know, I say, you know, and I still miss 20 questions and everything. Well, it's because you haven't been preparing for the whole semester. You haven't been doing what you haven't been doing. So I'm telling you, that's what it is, you know? So this is helpful for the ones who kind of like into the game here and can kind of focus a little bit. All right. And you see the most significant effect on colonists, you know, again, with the French defeat, is just like, you know, just kind of just hunkering down on them. I do want you to say, even though, you know, you do need some notes, some chronology here for sure, that just for information here, just that, like, instead of always telling, you know, people, like, again, causes of American Revolution and War, no taxation without representation, again, you've learned some stuff in here that's like a little bit, that's going to make you kind of stand out a little bit. I'm trying to give you some nuance and sophistication. You can just say it was more about really, you know, enlightenment, self-autonomy, sovereignty. All the colonial governments is already here. And really, the geography, as Thomas Paine alluded to. Like, you know, you're 3,000 miles away, you're an island or a continent. So those are the things that really caused the American Revolution. Should you have some kind of chronology? I do want you to know that, like, you know, that, like, what led to the other thing here, like that, you know, like you should know, like, the Boston massacres before, you know, the Tea Act and the Intolerable Act slash Coercive Act. You get it? And before then was a Townsend, you know, acts before in the Declaratory Act. So get out some kind of like little chronology and see if you have that in your head. That's one question. And you got to remember, each question is 1 point. pick your like, you know, where you where your weaknesses or your strengths, and you know, maybe work on those. And you know what I'm big on? And I have a sheet up there in the folder, I promise you. You know, First Continental Congress versus Second Continental Congress. You know, when did they form? First one after, like, you know, the Coercive Acts, things that they're known for, you know, in there. Just to say one, you know, they formed the association, the First Continental Congress. You know, they want to boycott all goods. One of the most significant things right there in getting all people together. They don't want to separate yet. You know, second one happens after Lexington Concourse. Hey, you know, things are getting deep. You get the Olive Branch petition. You get a committee that's going to do the Declaration of Independence. You get George Washington. So look at that sheet about, again, just settling in your head, First Continental Congress versus Second Continental Congress in your head. Really good. And then, you know, again, Thomas Paine, the original T. Paine there, like, you know, talking about there, just besides the Declaration of Independence. I don't think I have any too much questions about the Declaration of Independence as much and everything. Well, kind of looking at it right now. So I said, again, you know, well, I mean, you know, it's, well, I guess I had to correct myself like that. So he's like, oh, Mr. Price, that's probably some kind of question. Well, it's related to, I'm being kind of general here about human rights. You got to think that Thomas Jefferson, born from John Locke, made things so like universal and made you say like, made it relatable to what people want, you know? So, and what people all should enjoy. And now that power is not divine anymore, but it's coming from the kind of like, you know, the consent of the government. It means people. And I know they're not implying women and minorities, but it does sound very idyllic at this time. And you got the Treaty of Paris, one of the, you know, again, the second Treaty of Paris. You know, you have one in 1763 into the French and Indian War. You got this one, see what, and actually, you know, we do pretty good in that as well. Just because AP loves it a lot, you know, your Republican motherhood about like, you know, oh, ladies like singing everything, you know, you helped us during the war. You had Daughters of Liberty along with the Sons of Liberty, like, you know, protesting here and boycotting with goods and stuff like that. So, forming an American society, what can make American society great is that, and it came off this kind of like, you know, consolation prize, if I want to call it, almost in a way, of this, you know, Republican motherhood. And you make sure you had that kind of in your head. Make sure you know that, like, you know, a lot of manumission societies start forming in the late 18th century after the war. You know, the guy thinking about slavery, we're talking about, like, you know, equality like that. And here we got like so many people enslaved and high ideals. That's going to start changing and saying what we're going to do. And there's going to be a lot of debate though. Now, once they're free, what do? Colonization, you know, like that, you know, or when do they do it? Is it immediate? Is it gradual? Like that. So that's going to be, you know, thinking about those things as well. So, I love the Articles of Confederation, even though every person, you know, scraps it, hates it. Even for, you know, a commie like me who kind of likes, you know, a good, effective government, it's easy to beat up on the articles. You say it's weak, it's weak. You should have, and I'm going to put that in a folder. You should know the Northwest Ordinance, you know, the land ordinance, you know, it honored about like, you know, state governments, you know, it kept that up and everything. So, and you know, states' rights and everything, have a weak central government. All these things are strengths of the Articles of Confederation. I mean, hey, you know, I keep on saying the peace treaty in 1783, Treaty of Paris, it negotiated and handled international affairs. Probably the underlying problem of it and everything is not regulating commerce. And as we know from 1781 to approximately 1789, this is known as the critical period under the Articles of Confederation. What makes it critical is because the economy is, you know, really at a low, and we're really at the whim of like Great Britain and well, France is going through their kind of like turmoil right now, or the other European powers at this time. So we're kind of like, you know, that's what's probably really making critical. What's going to happen here? Shays' Rebellion happens during this time. They try to get together at the Annapolis Convention. Nobody really, you know, shows up. So, you know, they say, hey, look, we got to get together. Just come to Philadelphia, try to bring everybody together in 1787. Again, it formed a constitution to form a stronger national government. But again, look at like the strengths of the Ark of Confederation. So let's think about that. So, all right. So, making it, maybe if I can make it about almost 40 here, so like that. So, doing a, a constitutional convention, all that stuff about, great compromise, like that. That might be, you should learn that since first grade, some things about that. So, what why are people against the, Constitution? They, why does Patrick Henry smell a rat? Because they think it's too much concentrated power. We're returning to a strong central government. What about our civil liberties? All right. Now, again, the people who are calling themselves like, the Federalists say, hey, it's going to be okay. There's going to be factions, but people will check each other because of how large it is. So, so that's where they go. And, most of these supporters, you said, not necessarily they're from the North, but they're more mostly business people, successful entrepreneurs and stuff to themselves, who call themselves, label themselves supporters of the Constitution, eventually going to be known as like, Federalists. Again, we're not into political parties yet. You don't really get into political parties really to the second term of George Washington, where you get these things kind of defined. These are into factions by the Anti-Federalists and the Federalists. Right? Again, Hamilton's financial plan, first thing about Washington, to be fat, you really think about like, he wants to fund the debt. He wants to create our credit. He wants the states to be aligned, like to the owe allegiance to the national government. And again, he wants other countries to invest in us. Genius, again, he can look at, far ahead about that. And I think a lot of you guys, will say, I guess history has kind of like been very more favorable to him like that, especially with the $500 ticket sales that you, or even more, like it's again for a seat, like again everything, to, with his like enjoyed a lot of recent kind of like pub and everything. And I think you guys kind of know. I one of the questions on there too is the first five presidents. Like, please know about like which you need to match up a little bit here. Like George Washington, what happened to Jay's Treaty, Pinckney's Treaty, you get down in that Whiskey Rebellion. John Adams, XYZ, Quasi War, Alien Sedition Act, like that, response to the Virginia Kentucky Resolution. You get the Revolution of 1800. You got John Adams appoints the Midnight Judges, but then you get Marbury versus Madison. And you get the G.I. Hate Lamb with Jefferson. You don't have to know the whole thing about G.I. Hate Lamb from the Louisiana Purchase, the Barbary Pirates, the Embargo Act, them trying to impeach some judges, him acting more like a, Federalist than a Republican, like that. And he's always said that you got to like, strict constructions of the Constitution, but then he kind of like, was kind of loosely like based on that. Only time I think he really like, he was trying to be really strict. He did get rid of the whiskey tax and some of the direct excise taxes on here. So, and then you move up again, Mr. Madison's War. It's the War of 1812. You gotta know, man, the Hartford Convention really destroys, really the Federalist Party at this time. Makes heroes out of William Henry Harrison, Andrew Jackson. Remember, it wasn't just about impressment. The Indians of Northwest Territory, Ohio is always, that area is always prime like that. So with James Madison, he does not renew the bank, but in 1816 he renews the bank. Then he starts going on partly with some of the American system, with that, and it's going to bleed over to, James Monroe. And James Monroe, is there good feelings or is it, like that, Missouri Compromise, is that like grab the wolf by the ears? Is the slavery issue is going on here? What are they going to do? Rush-Pigot Treaty, Convention of 1818, deciding the borders and the north borders of the United States, Adams Onis Treaty. We're figuring out our boundaries and stuff on the north. We're taking like, Florida, paying them some money, or we're going to send Andrew Jackson down there. I don't know if you remember that. As capitalism, there's economic panic. All right. So in 1819 is a downturn. It's the dot-com. Again, you can learn specifics of that. He leaves office with the Monroe Doctrine, and it's really is kind of like, trying to settle, say, make a proclamation that like we're going to defend the Western Hemisphere, but we're not going to go into Europe. And the immediate effect of that, really, I know this is going to, it's not really nobody because of communication and everything, you know, it's something that becomes more powerful as the years go by. Not really so much when he first states it. All right. I'm going to like, you know, because I'm going to try to keep these things at 30 minutes, and I'm going to like, you know, try to like get this one going on here. I'm going to like turn this off, and then I'll make part two.